Hey, this is Dr. K from iMedicalSchool, and today we're going to talk about renal tubular acidosis. As the name sounds, renal tubular acidosis is when the serum pH becomes more acidic due to changes in the normal function of the kidneys. Briefly, let's talk about how acid and bases are regulated within the body. The two main organs that are involved in maintaining adequate acid-base balance are the lungs and the kidneys. If the serum pH is in the acidic range, the lungs are able to expel acid in the form of carbon dioxide. On the other hand, if the serum pH is alkaline, the respiratory rate slows down and we retain CO2 to compensate. The kidneys act in a similar manner but take longer to compensate for changes in the acid-base equilibrium. In the future, we will discuss renal physiology, but overall, the kidney excretes ammonium in the urine to release acid, and in rare circumstances can excrete bicarbonate. There are three types of renal tubular acidosis. They are type 1, which affects the distal convoluted tubule, type 2, which affects the proximal convoluted tubule, and type 4, which is due to hypoaldosteronism, or a low aldosterone state. A type 3 RTA does exist, but it is extremely rare and is caused by an enzyme deficiency. I would not focus on type 3 RTA, but really pay attention to types 1, 2, and 4. In terms of presentation, the renal tubular acidoses present in a similar fashion. If you obtain an ABG in basic lab work, you may notice a metabolic acidosis with a normal anion gap. A normal anion gap with a metabolic acidosis is generally due to renal tubular acidosis, gastrointestinal losses, or medications. To differentiate, we calculate the urine anion gap. To do this, sum the urine sodium and urine potassium, then subtract the urine chloride from the total. If the urine anion gap is greater than zero, then the metabolic acidosis is due to a renal tubular acidosis. But if it is negative, then it's due to gastrointestinal losses. This is an easy way to identify if a metabolic acidosis is due to renal tubular acidosis. Now let's briefly talk about the anatomy of the nephron. So the nephron is the basic unit that composes the kidneys. There are millions of nephrons that comprise the kidney, all of different sizes. Blood flows through the afferent arteriole into the glomerulus. Around the glomerulus is the Bowman's capsule. The capsule allows for absorption of ions, water, and waste products into the tubules. Whatever is not absorbed passes down into the efferent arteriole. The filtrate that is absorbed passes into the proximal convoluted tubule, where bicarbonate is absorbed, and then it proceeds into the loop of Henle. In the loop of Henle, the urine is concentrated, and finally it goes into the distal convoluted tubule. In the distal convoluted tubule, this is where most acid secretion takes place in the form of ammonium and phosphate. Now let's briefly look at the renal physiology. So looking at our glomerulus apparatus, we see that as filtrate flows through the PCT or proximal convoluted tubule, bicarb is reabsorbed out of the tubule. The filtrate passes through the loop of Henle and then into the distal convoluted tubule where ammonium enters and acid is excreted. Remember that as you talk about the renal tubular acidosis. So let's talk about the different RTAs. Let's begin by talking about RTA type 1. As we discussed before, RTA type 1 is a process that affects the distal convoluted tubule. As we remember, the distal convoluted tubule is involved in acid secretion. So if the distal convoluted tubule is unable to excrete acid, we actually produce an alkaline urine. Type 1 RTA presents with a hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis. Causes of an RTA type 1 include autoimmune disorders such as lupus or rheumatoid arthritis, amphotericin B, lithium, sarcoidosis, or other medications, and Wilson's disease. Laboratory findings include hypokalemia or low potassium. An important point in the patient's history is if the patient has had a history of kidney stones, otherwise known as nephrolithiasis. Kidney stones are commonly seen in RTA type 1. The serum bicarbonate in RTA type 1 is less than 10, which is a key distinctive factor of RTA type 1. In addition, the urine pH is greater than 6. The treatment of RTA type 1 is to give the patient bicarbonate. The reason why is because the kidneys cannot excrete acid, so acid builds up within the serum. Sodium bicarbonate helps balance the acid-base physiology. Now let's proceed to discuss about renal tubular acidosis type 2. 2. RTA type 2 presents with a hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis, just like RTA type 1. The dysfunction in RTA type 2 is an impaired ability to reabsorb bicarbonate, specifically in the proximal tubule. RTA type 2 can be due to Fanconi syndrome, monoclonal gammopathies, such as multiple myeloma or amyloidosis. In addition, medications like acetazolamide can also cause an RTA type 2, as well as glycogen storage diseases. In an RTA type 2, you may see glucose, bicarbonate, and phosphate within the urine. All patients with an RTA type 2 should be screened for a monoclonal gammopathy, such as multiple myeloma or amyloidosis. The key findings of an RTA type 2 include a urine pH greater than 7 and a serum bicarb above 14 to 20. Now, the reason why the urine pH is so high is because the bicarb in the urine cannot be reabsorbed. The bicarb actually gets lost in the urine, thus making the urine alkaline. The treatment of an RTA type 2 includes diuretics as well as bicarbonate. Let's finally talk about renal tubular acidosis type 4. In RTA type 4, we have a hyporenin and a hypoaldosteronism state that is due to either aldosterone insufficiency or resistance to the effects of aldosterone. That insufficiency or resistance can be due to primary adrenal insufficiency, antibiotics, ACE inhibitors, or spironolactone. The key diagnostic finding is measuring the renin and aldosterone levels. There are other features that you can look for to help diagnose an RTA type 4. Generally, the serum bicarb will be greater than 17, and the urine pH should be less than 5.5. But the key finding is hyperkalemia, or elevated potassium. The treatment of an RTA type 4 is a low potassium diet and a loop diuretic. So let's break everything down into the key points for renal tubular acidosis. The key points to really take away are that there are three types of renal tubular acidoses that are clinically significant. They are RTA type 1, RTA type 2, and RTA type 4. RTA type 1 is distinctive in that the serum bicarb can be very low with a bicarb less than 10. In addition, these patients are prone to develop kidney stones. In RTA type 2, the urine pH is very high. The urine pH is usually greater than 7, which is a distinctive feature of type 2. Finally, a distinctive feature of type 4 is hyperkalemia or elevated potassium. Well, that's a brief review of renal tubular acidosis. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did enjoy this video, make sure to share, comment, like, and subscribe. Also, make sure to follow us on Twitter at iMedSchool as well as on Facebook and Google Plus at iMedicalSchool. This is Dr. K, and I'll see you next time.